All right. It has been a full night since the events in the poor quarter, where you saw some sort of sphere be hurled into a mist of peasants. Well, poor folk. No, I guess they're not technically peasants in the Empire. And small little flecks of what was identified as warpstone went flying into the crowd and somehow transformed numerous people into horrific abominations.
Right.
You put the abominations down. You spoke with Otto. He basically forced all of you to retreat back to the Iron Bull to rest for an evening.
Okay. So are we free to do as we wish right now?
You are free to do as you wish.
I want to set out to the Temple of Mor to check.
You may split at any point during this duo session, but if you split, you will not meet again until a certain time.
Okay.
I am also interested in going to the Temple of Mor.
Okay. I will begin my narrative with the elf this time. Vivandrel, as you come downstairs, having had a fitful night's rest. By the way, if you had any damage from last session, you only heal one wound. You are not back at full yet.
Magnificently. I only took 1 point of damage from being hit with a stick.
I don't remember what I was at. I think I was at 9.
Well, so I'll take your word for it.
So I'm back to full health.
So as Vivandrel comes downstairs looking fully refreshed, you see the Morrite seems to have awoken a little bit before you and seems to be making his way towards the front door, moving with a sense of purpose. Hulse looks rather groggy, as y'all are both up rather early, and neither of your companions have stirred yet. They're not actually there.
Those are just figments of our imagination.
I will be a little less lazy and move them to a different layer so you can't see them. There! They're invisible now!
Yay.
Okay, so I am walking towards the door.
Priest, where are you going?
The temple. Do you wish to come with?
I can think of literally nothing better to do.
Very well.
Fitful. All right, you make your way across town. The atmosphere is rather tense around most of the city. Rumors have spread about about what occurred in the poor quarter, though from what you hear, people are getting a lot of things wildly wrong. Most people seem to think it was not nearly as bad as it actually was, but there are the occasional few who seem to think it's really bad. You see more literal doomsayers on street corners saying the end is coming and Sigmar is here to punish our sins and all sorts of other nasty things. A few people seem to be moving out of the city, heading out to the south, trying to evacuate. But it's a pretty small amount of people. Most people seem fairly calm.
Are there more guards around?
Yeah, there's a pretty heavy patrol around most parts of the city. It seems that Nolan is definitely on edge, waiting for whatever's about to happen next. And there's, of course, a lot of talk about the burning boulder that destroyed the Eastern Gate yesterday.
Okay.
And I imagine the one that smashed into the wall not so far before.
Yeah. That being said, you make it to the temple without terrible incident, but as you approach the temple, it gets busier and busier and busier as there are constantly this almost never-ending torrent of corpses being brought into the temple.
This bodes ill.
But you arrive without too much ill. You actually get into the temple, you get past where most of the bodies are being prepared. So it's not like crazy busy, but it's still pretty bustling with activity. It's very noisy.
So before before we actually enter into the temple, I'm going to stop and turn to the elf and say, "Elf, I need to speak with you about something."
Then speak.
It's like, I must give you my thanks for standing at the temple a few days back. I should have been there, and you were there in my stead, so you have my gratitude for that.
Why should you have been there?
It is my duty to fight with my fellows.
Do you intend to stand guard every night from now on?
No, but I will not fail in my duties again. I swore that oath, and I take it very seriously.
As you will.
Okay, so at that I turn and start walking towards the temple.
Okay.
I walk alongside.
Elf, take a perception check, please.
Okay.
And you are using your sight, so keep in mind you're at plus 20%.
I pass in any case. 23.
Alright, basically all I'm going to use this check to tell you is that you're able to actually get a rough estimate of the scale of the dead. Fowl's not able to guess purely based on just seeing the corpses around, but you can you actually have a pretty alarming prediction of it looks like about at least 500 dead.
Do I notice anything peculiar about them, or...?
Most of them appear to have been crushed. Some bear really strange-looking burns. Almost as if that part of their body was frozen, like it's almost blue and frostbitten. But it still... But it has that waxy look of burns.
Charming. In any case,
do I notice the elf looking around?
Yes.
See something in particular, elf?
I see a great many bodies, as you also see yourself.
Yes, it's troublingly so.
This is a graveyard.
Aye, but that does not mean we wish to have frequent customers.
Customers. Shall we?
Yes.
Okay, you make your way into the official area of the Temple of Mor. The guards are on extremely high alert. That being said, they do recognize the both of you and do not make an attempt to stop you.
I nod respectfully these are black guards, correct?
Yes, these are black guards.
I nod respectfully to the black guards and enter the temple.
I am sure they would prefer. I do not acknowledge them and I move in.
So, at this point, I start walking into the main area of the temple, and I approach one of the priests.
Okay, you both enter the temple. The first person that you see that really catches your interest, Mikael, is that you spy the elderly priest that you first met behind the altar, walking around the mist. He appears pretty exhausted, but he's still performing his duties well enough.
I walk up to him. Which priest is he in the thing?
Right smack in the middle.
Oh, the guy that's right in front of my guy?
Yes, that one.
Okay. So I walk up to him and give him my greetings.
He nods and says, "Ah, what brings you here? Are you here to help us with the rites? There are quite a few jobs to still be done."
I had come to scour the archives, but if you need require my assistance, you will have it.
He frowns and shakes his head, says, "No, look into whatever you must. We can handle the load, though if you do find some free time, do feel free to come and assist us."
Has High Priest Ravencloak returned?
He frowns and looks down at the ground and says, "Strangely, no. You figure in this such a dark time when we need him most, he would have reappeared, but for some reason no one has seen him lately."
Intriguing. And Anna, where is she?
He shrugs.
Any sign of her dog?
Not in the church.
Okay.
Cathedral, whatever.
Yeah. Which way to the archives?
He gestures you over to the small room. There's a small set of stairs that leads down to a sort of basement area where they keep most of their archives.
Okay. I'm going to... start heading that way.
Okay, so where we left off, Fowl, you were moving Mikael off towards the archives,
yep.
Which are in the downstairs of that smaller room.
Okay.
And Vivandrel, you wanted to approach the elderly priest who you have also met before?
Yes.
So I'm going to pause and respectfully wait for Vivandrel to finish her business.
I'm not going to the bathroom.
No, I meant finish her conversation before I leave and abandon
hey,
her.
Hey, priest, check this out.
Okay, I'm back. A pleasure to see you again, priest.
He squints at you for a moment, and Nazi says, "Ah, yes, I remember you now. I see that you're... I didn't realize that you were in the company of the Doomsayer."
It's hard to forget sometimes. How is my friend from the gardens?
He seems to frown, perplexed for a moment. You figure maybe his age has him not quite as sharp as he used to be.
The priestess.
At this, his eyebrows shoot up and he says, "Ah, yes, she went to the Temple of Sigmar not long ago. Father Ravencloak took her before he returned. We did see him, though. He said that she had safely been delivered and was being taken outside of the city. I think he said they were taking her to Altdorf."
I'll take that as a good sign, then. Where is Father Ravencloak?
He shrugs with a frown, says, "As I was telling your friend over there, unfortunately we haven't seen him at least the last 2 days. We're not really sure where he went."
He didn't tell you where he was going.
He shakes his head.
So be it. Where is Anna?
At this, he frowns deeply again and says, "She disappeared yesterday. We haven't seen her since. Honestly, I'm getting pretty worried about the girl. Normally, she's back by now."
I have a very funny feeling she may be coming back with me in tow. Let's hope, shall we?
He nods.
I was wondering a couple of things if you had time, but I see that you're fairly busy.
He nods and says, "If it can wait, I would appreciate it. We'll probably be busy for at least the next day or so. There are many dead that need to be interred, unfortunately."
So I notice. Why are there so many?
He shakes his head and says, "Apparently there was some sort of festival or something going on close to the East Gate. Too close. When the stone hit, it crushed many of the bystanders, and it flung debris into many of those standing around."
A tragedy, I'm sure. I've taken enough of your time, though. Thank you very much.
He bobs his head appreciatively and starts heading back outside and seems to be gearing himself up.
Those terrible labors, yes. I follow Foul.
I nod to the elf and turn and start walking to the archives again.
Alright, unlike last time, you find the archives rather empty and unguarded. There's nobody down there. You're guessing the temple has emptied all of its reserves, staff-wise, to deal with the current issue at hand.
This is a troubling sign.
Or an encouraging one.
I find the... If the temple is so understaffed that it needs all, even the archivist, that is not a good sign for the number of dead.
I find an open library a very good thing when we have questions.
True. Now let's see if the tomes I'm looking for have been returned.
Do we not have another map for this?
No, it's not that large of a library. Yeah.
Fair enough.
As you wander down to the archives, you approach a similar... You follow in your mind vaguely the direction you went the last time when you were being guided by an archivist, and you find that the section where you expect to find all of the tomes that the Morrites have gathered on beastmen and all potential raids they've dealt with in at least the last 20 years are gone.
Hmm. Intriguing. I was worried this would still be the case.
Still be the case?
Last time I went, I heard that Father Ravencloak had taken these tomes. It is rather troubling that they haven't been returned, as they could have offered us answers.
He took all of them.
Yes, and that's the disturbing thing.
How many empty shelves are there, Sotek?
There's about three. It seems like a ridiculous amount of books for him to have taken himself.
So I thought.
Hmm.
Is there anything here on the Rathman?
That's another thing I should be... And that's the other thing I came here to look. I didn't have high hopes for the Beastmen.
Take a... search check. Merton only.
Mikael.
Mikael.
You do not locate any books, at least in the area that you are in, that seem to mention anything of the Ratmen. You could continue searching, but it may take some time.
Hmm. Do you have any other business that you wish to attend to, or who? My friend?
I had some questions. I meant them for the priest, but if you think you could answer them, I suppose that would suffice.
Ask away. This will probably take me some time.
Why do you dream?
I assume you mean more than just the normal sense, yes?
Your prophecies, yes.
Ah. A very good question, though not exactly a most rather easily answered one. You know, you've heard the ways that the others refer to me, yes? Death priest and the like?
I may have.
Well, while accurate, they're not completely true. More my our patron, I gesture through the entire temple as I keep sifting through the bookshelves, is not simply just the god of death. He is also the god of dreams and night. And when priests such as I, or young Anna, in fact, dream, he guides us through that realm of darkness and stuff to events that may be to come. Those of us who have this gift are referred to as augurs.
Why does he do this?
More is the god of death, but he does not wish for all to die, only for those to die when their time comes. And if there is an event to come that would lead to many dying before their time, he sends those like myself or others of my order, the doomsayers, to try and prevent non-natural deaths. Perhaps it is best to think of it as we keep the death in its natural state, as opposed to letting it run freely.
You're uninterested in physical relationships, aren't you?
I pause and turn and look at the elf and say, physical?
I thought so. Is it the same for all of you?
Yes, though others are not as, let's just say that I take to it more easily than others.
Or against it?
Yeah, yes.
What is Anna?
A young girl? I do not... perhaps you should be more forthcoming with what it is about her that you wish to know.
She's one of you, but she's different as well. Human children, I imagine, are not normally so strong, so eager.
Ah, yes. She is an interesting case. The High Priest Ravencloak, actually rescued... skewed her from the beastmen horde that worship the one eye. And he's been raising her as his granddaughter.
When was this?
He told me about five or six years ago. Was that out of character? Is that about right, Sotek? To what he told me?
Yeah, that's about rough, right? Yeah.
I have a very strange feeling we may need to find that girl again at some point.
I'm having that feeling as well.
That was all I wondered.
Okay, can I make another search check?
At this point, you have located a single tome mentioning some vague references of the Underfolk. But as you lay your hands upon it, you see quite a bit of empty space around it, and it almost looked like it fell. And you see that a lot of the dust around the area where you would expect to see many more books about Skaven has been greatly disturbed.
I think I found something, but this is quite curious.
There's only the one.
Indeed. But it looks like the others have been removed. At this, I pull out the book.
Which book?
The book that's about the Skaven.
Okay. You have two books. I'm not sure which one you said.
Yeah. Not the one I'm carrying around at all times. The other one.
Okay. Perform a read check.
Enjoy that read checks are an actual thing.
can I fortune point that, or?
Yeah, you can.
I'm trying to decide if I really want to, though.
Bear in mind that I do have common knowledge elves, and the dwarf knows a lot more about the ratmen than even I do.
Can I take this book with me?
Yes.
Then
well, there's no one around, so.
I'll leave it as is then.
Okay.
So I'm assuming I don't find anything.
It's written, it's very old. It is very old. There's a little bit of artwork, and it's pretty difficult to read, especially in this low lighting, and you just can't make out the words.
I can't find anything of use right now, but I have a feeling this tome may be of use to us later. Very well.
Be sure to add that to your inventory.
Yep.
We should take it then.
Yeah, indeed. What's the name of the book, Sotek?
Just call it Book of the Underfolk. For now.
Fair enough.
Same encumbrance as the other book?
Sure.
Are we here for anything else, or...?
No, though I agree with you. I have a feeling we should find Dana.
Okay, you head back into the cathedral at large.
Yep. I exit the archives.
Okay, most of the priests have actually left at this point to go back to work. There's a few stragglers, seemingly mourners or people making various prayers, maybe someone who got lucky and managed to survive.
Normally I'd stop to let them know that I've taken this. But I think they have others on their things on their mind. Though I still should probably let them know at some point.
It may be better if we didn't.
Perhaps. With dealing with foes such as this. Now where to find Anna? Perhaps we should check the garden itself.
Perhaps. I can imagine. I can imagine she might enjoy that.
Yes. If only we had found... it bothers me. Normally there's a dog, which I presume to be hers here. Its absence is grating.
So you head out to the graveyard?
Yep.
Alright, you make your way out to the graveyard, and as you approach the outer gate, you notice there are no guards, but you also notice a familiar furry figure sitting at it.
There he is. I approach the dog.
He seems aggravated somewhat at Mikael's presence, but as he looks at Vivandrel, he seems to calm somewhat, and he actually gets up and starts heading into the maze that leads towards the garden, and as he gets almost turns a corner, he seems to stop and wait for the two of you.
It appears we have a guide.
Very observant.
Yes.
Okay, you follow the black dog through the maze of various black roses and high bushes, various trees, some rather exotic plants, no small amount of tombstones, a couple of mausoleums, and eventually he finally leads you to the familiar place of Ravencloak's garden. But as you arrive at the cusp, at the stairs that lead down to it, the dog turns and quickly skirts into the nearest bush and is gone.
Righty, Grytox.
Okay, you both enter the garden, and you see Father Ravencloak, Frederick Ravencloak, sitting on the ground with his back against the well that he draws no small amount of water from, and Anna is leaning against him, and they both appear to be sleeping.
Oh, we've found our missing father.
A fantastic mystery.
Indeed.
Elf, roll a perception check.
Oh dear.
Is this with his sight?
There we are.
Yes. I need to break Izzy into the practice of this.
Yes.
Okay, and I apologize for... You get plus 10% when you're using your sight. Okay, I'm going to type you something.
Okay.
And be sure to change it from Izzy to Vivandrel, please.
Sorry.
Small complaint.
We were out for 15 minutes. Didn't know.
It's all good.
Reset after...
Yes, that's fine.
Oh, that's true. Okay.
Plus 10. This is beginning to irritate me. Roll 20 is very kindly not saving my stats properly.
We'll figure it out. It could be that it's freaking out a little bit. I'll take a look at it later, though.
Priest, check the exits.
Understood.
Ready my
hammer and shield. Do I take a perception check?
Sure, you can. You look around the garden and glance out each of the stairways. It seems that y'all are alone.
I move over to Anna and Ravencloak.
Okay, as you get close, you can hear Anna softly humming some sort of lullaby.
Anna?
Her eyes snap open rather alertly, and she almost jumps a little. And she looks at you and she says, "Oh, you're here! What took y'all so long? I've been waiting."
Why were you waiting?
She pouts for a moment and says, "Grandfather said y'all would be coming here. He told me to wait."
Is Father Ravencloak all right?
She rolls her eyes a little bit and says, "No, he's dead, silly."
Why? Whose dagger is that?
She looks down and said, "Oh, it's his. He asked me to stab him with it."
Did he say why?
She nods and she very carefully and gently reaches up to his neck and pulls out a small glowing green fleck of stone and holds it out to you.
That is not a good sign.
On the contrary, I think it's a fantastic sign.
Oh?
We know that what they know. Partially.
She drops the fleck on the ground and says, "He was in pain, and he made me promise that I would help him, so I ended him. I put him out of his suffering, and he went to Moore, just like Grandfather Moore told me I would do."
Anna, have you done the rites?
She shakes her head. "Oh, he wanted me to give you this," and she holds out a sealed letter to Mikael.
"Thank you." I walk over to Father Ravencloak and perform the rites.
Well done.
Okay, you perform the beginning of the cursory rites performed upon finding a corpse. Would you like to look at the letter?
Can I finish the rites first, or should I?
You perform the basic levels of it, but you should probably look at it now.
Okay. I love how it says Young Merton.
Anna.
She looks up.
Priest, will the Blackguard accept this version of events?
One moment, Elf.
One moment.
Yes.
Anna carefully sets down Frederick's cold arm at this point, and she sort of... She doesn't seem quite as bubbly as she normally is, and she walks over to the elf and sort of grabs her hand, just sort of stands there.
Anna, where did that green speck come from? Did Ravencloak say?
She shakes her head, says, no, he showed up here, and he was... He sounded like he was in a lot of pain. All he told me was to make sure that letter got to him, and she points at Mirton.
To Mikael.
And, oh, no. Right, Mikael. Sorry.
I like to point out the letter out of character. The letter actually said Mirton.
Whoops.
Izzy, change your name.
Retcon.
Yep, retcon.
And she sort of shrugs and says, and then he asked me to stab him, like I told him, because I promised him I'd do anything he asked. He was always good to me, so it's the least I could do for him.
It's all right, Anna. You did as he requested. He is with Moore now.
She goes, oh, I know. Grandfather told me that, well, Grandfather Ravencloak would be joining him soon. I was supposed to be here for this.
Yes, and it appears that we are to take you into our care now.
She sort of glances at the both of you and she says, does that mean I get to leave the temple? I don't have to stay here anymore, do I? I don't have to stay with Sigmund?
No. You're with us now.
She looks visibly relieved, and her bubbly mood starts to pick up again.
Anna, do you know where Father's Ravencloak would like to be buried?
She sort of glances around. She says, probably here. He always talked about the bodies are decent nourishment for black roses.
Well then. It appears I'm in need of a shovel.
We have to do this ourselves? Surely they would like to know where he is first.
Yes. So, but unfortunately, if you notice, we don't have any shovels here, so we must go back to the temple anyways.
Anna nods, says, and I have to get my stuff. If I'm going to be leaving, I have to have my stuff.
Yes. So let's head back then.
She excitedly talks about some of her favorite straw dolls as the three of you walk back to the temple.
Okay. I walk up to... I immediately start heading to one of, like, the elderly priest. I look around for the elderly priest.
Give me one sec.
Okay.
Remember, Great Axe is still ready.
You should do well to put that away, Elf.
My hands are taken.
Anna sheepishly lets go of the hand she was holding. She says, you're not going to need to fight here. Not yet, anyway. That's what Grandfather told me.
Did he say when we would need to?
She shrugs.
Anna, when you speak of Grandfather, here, are you speaking of who I think you are?
She seems to look quizzically at the elf for a moment and then look back at you and she says, if you mean more, then yes. He talks to me all the time in my dreams. He likes to sit with me at his garden.
I envy you. I dream of nothing but death and destruction.
She sort of smiles at you and she says, that sounds exciting. Once again, she is utterly unfazed.
It is until you fail terribly the first time. And at this point, I start looking around for the elderly priest.
Okay, you actually see him standing outside the gate, the doors to the temple, talking to some of the guards. And he sees you approaching with Anna, and he starts hustling over. And as he approaches, he says, ah, I see you found Anna, but where is the father?
He is with Moore now. I require a shovel.
He almost, he seems to take a step back and clutch at his heart for a moment, and looks pretty wounded, but recovers himself very quickly into a steely expression and nods and says, "I'm afraid it's not quite so simple as burying him. There are very specific rites we have to perform for a member, someone as high-stationed as he."
Why?
He shrugs and says, "It's tradition in many ways. We have his will, though, here in the temple. I would like to excise it, if you don't mind."
"Yes, let's. He is in his personal rose garden. But if you would not mind, I would rather be the one to bury him."
He nods, and he tells you all to wait there, and heads inside. And when he comes back out, he's holding a small slip of paper that he stares down at intently, and when he approaches, he looks up at you with somewhat of a smirk and says, "Well, it's good you're doing it, seeing as he specifically requested that you do it. Sigmund isn't going to like this, but he's not around, so he does. So, quite frankly, I don't care what he thinks at the moment."
"When was the last time Sigmund was around, actually?"
He frowns and says, "The last time I saw him was before the stone impacted. He's been out there leading most of our work. With
good.
Ravencloak gone, he'll almost assuredly be taking over as the new High Priest."
I would request that you not let him know until I've finished with the burial."
He nods, and looking down at the small paper, he frowns and says, "That being said, the ritual he wished performed is quite difficult."
"May I see the paper? The will?"
He nods and hands it to you, and it contains extremely vague details about some sort of ritual that you've heard rumors of that is quite well restricted for very, very influential members within the Church of Mor. And it takes no small amount of time to perform, either. It takes regular visits throughout the course of a week.
"Well then, it appears I must get started. Do you have the materials?"
He nods and says, "Yes, you should be able to find them all in the storage shed that we keep." Ping.
"Okay, very well." And I start heading off the thing. "Anna, go find your stuff and meet me in the shed."
She nods and starts running off, and the elderly man sort of frowns and he looks at the office.
I pause and say, "The father requested that we take Anna into our care."
He nods and glances over at the elf and says, "Aye, it would probably be best. With Ravencloak gone, I worry about Sigmund. They don't have the best history, those two."
"I noticed last I was present. What is the... Is there a story behind that?"
He shakes his head and says, "Another time, priest. Well, you have other duties to perform."
"Very well. Elf, would you lend me a hand?"
"Very well."
And I enter the shed.
Okay, you find the various things that you need. And although the ritual is extremely vague, if you read the letter that I gave you, you might find some useful information in there.
Can you pop that thing back up? It kind of closed.
Yeah, it should be visible any time. But there you go.
"Yes. And it's like, so first, as I'm rummaging through the thing, I kind of pause and say to the elf, I do not know if you have said this, but what perhaps is your name? I tire of simply calling you elf."
"Vivandrel."
"Thank you. I will remember it." And I gather the thing and stand outside waiting for Anna.
Okay, it doesn't take Anna long to approach with a very pretty small saddlebag at her side, and she's skipping and humming to herself as she approaches you. She nods enthusiastically.
"We could make it with that little belongings. We could make a proper doomsday review. Come."
Okay, she also assists in carrying things out, and despite her rather small stature, she is quite a bit stronger than she looks.
Okay, and I head back to the garden.
Okay. We don't actually need to change the map for this.
Okay.
But you make your way to the garden and drop off all the supplies you will need for the full week-long ritual there at the garden.
And do I start the ritual now, or?
You can if you wish. Before you begin, I will turn my attention to Vivandrel, in that Vivandrel, you can stay and help out. You can take Anna and go back to the Iron Bowl and wait for him, or at this point you two may split up and go on your own adventures.
I'll take Anna back to the Iron Bowl, provided that Fowl's coming back as soon as he finishes. Fowl's character.
Mikael, do you agree to this?
Yes.
Okay. I will focus on Mikael then. We will focus on Vivandrel because Mikael's just going to be rolling checks.
Yep. Do I start rolling checks?
Back to the Iron Bowl. Da, 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 da. Yes. That being said, you may... if you know the proper thing to use, you may... what's the word I'm looking for? Have a bonus to your check.
I pull out the Book of Doorways and begin reading.
Good job. Yeah, go ahead and perform your first check. In between each check, we'll do little things with what's going on in the end. Alright, one successful. Good job. Alright, Vivandrel, you arrive back at the Iron Bull, and Anna is practically bouncing off the walls.
Before they leave, can I say something to the elf?
Yes, you may.
I said, Elf, Vivandrel, when you get to Holst, tell him that Ravencloak is calling in his favor.
Very well.
Keep her safe. Okay.
Vivandrel, you return to the Iron Bull. Your arm is a little bit sore from having to keep Anna from running off every which direction, catching her by the scruff of her collar every time she almost runs down some alley chasing some new thing that she's seeing, because she doesn't get out of the temple very much.
I have a feeling this is going to be an interesting dynamic between our characters.
Well, as long as she's ready to whack heads off things, I'm good.
That being said, you make it back to the inn in roughly good order, though she has nearly been talking nonstop about the various cats or people or things that she has seen along the way.
Barkeep, I say, approaching the bar.
Okay, as you approach with Anna in tow, he frowns down for a moment and says, If I'm not mistaken, that's little Anna. And he leans over and looks at her and says, I remember when you were just a wee lass. My, you've grown. What's she doing here?
You have a new tenant.
He frowns. he frowns very deeply at this news.
Ravencloak is calling in his favor.
At this, he pales a little bit, and he seems to lean over rather heavily, and he says, Ah, the old bastard finally croaked, then.
That's one way of putting it.
Shakes his head, says, I knew he'd never call in that favor while he was alive. That son of a bitch kept me hooked on that for 10 years before finally calling it in.
What exactly does it entail?
He sort of smirks and says, Well, let's just say I tried to be a little bit too adventurous in one part of my youth and got close to something that wasn't exactly easy to hit with just a regular old weapon. Old Ravencloak saved my arse. I owed him for that one. Unfortunately, he remembered. He nods and says, The usual drink, then.
Sure.
As he prepares, Anna sort of sits up on her stool and says, I'll have one too, and Holst gives a very disapproving frown in her general direction.
This is not for children.
Holst says, Now, Master Elf, I'm sure we can make it work, and only where you can just see him. He puts the slightest, tiniest bit of wine, like so tiny it's not even funny, and a literal, like, almost full cup of water, and just pretends to mix it just as well as yours, and passes them out accordingly. And Anna pouts in your direction and says, See, I can handle it. I'm just like you. If I drink this, I'll be just as pretty as you are, right? And then she seems to frown for a moment. She says, or was it something about repeating a phrase in the dark? She seems a little lost in memory.
Do I roll another check?
Not yet.
There we go.
Fucking hell.
Did I just say that Anna is my favorite character in this whole RP?
Y'all don't even know the half of it.
I smile slightly and take a gulp of the thing I've been given.
She matches your gulp and winces at the so strong drink. Foul, you can roll another check. Alright, another pass. Good job.
How many more?
Alright, you got 5 more to go.
Okay.
Alright, a full day rolls by. Anna quickly gets employed by Hulse to do the chores, much to her bemoanment. And she seems... And as you're wandering out of the inn, probably keeping a sharp eye out for things, you can literally hear her groaning as if she's dying as she mops the floors. And Hulse seems to take absolutely zero pity on her.
So is my guy stuck at the thing for the whole
yes,
week?
You may not leave.
Okay.
It is a very, very intensive ritual.
Okay.
Host leans over as he sees Anna working in the distance, grumbling something about mentioning Host to her grandfather. While and Hulse rolls his eyes and leans towards the elf and gets a rather serious look on his face and says, "So, how was he done in? There's no way that he died of natural causes. That old bastard still had at least a decade in him, by my reckoning."
You know him of old indeed, I see.
He shrugs and says, "He's always looked that old, at least as long as I can remember, and that didn't stop him from killing a vampire in single combat. I know a strong man when I see one, and that man was a monster."
A pity. We probably could have used him at some point.
He nods, and he frowns and says, "So what was it, then?"
"She killed him."
He raises an eyebrow at the girl and says, "The little one did."
"She did."
He whistles. He sort of whistles and says, "Somehow that doesn't really surprise me that much."
"No." He asked her to. "You may have heard of what went on in the east of the city, I presume."
He raises a hand sharply and looks has a very pained, like, genuinely pained expression on his face. And sort of winces at you and says, "Was it at least quick, then?"
"As near as we can tell."
He nods and says, "Good. That's all I want to hear about it, then." And he sort of seems to pause for a moment. He says, "That reminds me. Could I ask you for a favor?"
"If I can ask you for one in return?"
He gives you a flat look and says, "As long as it's not anything crazy, I'm asking you for something simple."
"Ask away."
He pulls out a little note with some writing on it and says, "Would you take this over to the Black Wolves Company headquarters, where Rolf is? He'll be wanting this."
"Sure. In return, who's this Shadow Wizard?" Not the one we've met.
Almeric. The
one above him.
You can hear him sucking on his teeth, and he says, "I don't know if it's wise to be talking about Almeric. That man has ears in places you wouldn't believe."
"I'm sure he's expecting at least one curious mouth."
He frowns for a moment, leans on the bar, and he says, "Tell you what, when you get back from delivering the letter, I'll tell you what you want to know about him."
"Very well. I'll hold you to that."
Another check?
Yep.
Reroll.
Okay.
You've got 2 fate points remaining?
Another date.
You will not get to reset for this.
Oh,
okay.
That is a pass.
Yep.
You're at plus 10% with the book.
Yep.
Alright, Vivandrel, you make your way. He tells you where to find the Black Wolves headquarters, which
massively
let me go ahead and tell you to while you're here. The Black Wolves headquarters is on Fortress Island.
Because of course it is.
They actually have a rather impressive setup. That being said, as you approach, you're stopped by a few guards who cross their very high-quality halberds, and these guys look like they know their business, before the doors and say, "Who goes there?"
Simply put, I do. I have a message for Captain Rolf.
One of them nods and says, "He's out at the moment. I'll be sure it's delivered to him, though, if he'd like to leave it."
I was asked to give it to him personally. Where is he?
One of them frowns and says, "He's at a meeting with the Countess, though he should be back by nightfall."
I'll wait.
They nod and gesture for you to go ahead and head inside. You enter Rolf's personal quarters, his office anyway. And it's pretty quaint, and you can definitely tell he's a very militaristic individual due to the fact that he has virtually zero furnishings beyond what he absolutely needs. It's all very tidy. That being said, you wait for evening to come, and Rolf eventually does arrive, and as he walks in the doors, he sees you and frowns for a moment and says, "I hope you're not here to tell me that the rest of the party has died."
That may be what my message says, but it would not be correct.
He nods and sits down. He says, "A message from Holst, then."
Of course.
He nods and holds out his hand.
I give him the message.
He reads it briefly for a moment, frowns down at it, and then looks up at you and says, "Ravencloak's dead."
Ravencloak's dead.
He swears profusely. You hear many, many curses referencing very numerous sensitive parts of numerous imperial gods. Before he finally slows down and takes a breath in and says, "Great, I just got back and now I'm going to have to go back to see the Countess to tell her of this news. This isn't going to be received well at all."
I imagine we could have used him, certainly.
He nods and says, "Ravencloak was a hero. He was a titan among men."
He was. You're aware of what happened in the poorer district of the city.
He nods and focuses on you with a very intense stare.
It is possible that much the same happened to him, to a lesser or greater degree. He was in great pain when he died, we're told. Some of the substance found there was found with him.
He shakes his head and leans back heavily in his chair and pinches the bridge of his nose and says, "Gods be damned. Very well. I'll be sure to inform the Countess of this. Seems that we'll need higher security on influential members of the court. Ravencloak was supposed to be coming to see her earlier today. He never arrived, though, of course, because apparently he's passed on. He was going to be bringing her news about our oncoming enemies."
Ravencloak apparently killed both a vampire and one of the kings of the south.
He nods and says, "Aye, that and much more."
How much security do you think would be useful, with that in mind?
He frowns at your suggestion, and there's a bit of a pause. And he shakes his head and says, "We all do what we must. Ravencloak should have known better than to be out in that garden of his by himself, because I'll bet at least 5 crowns that's where the old fool died."
Perhaps.
Always did like those damn flowers of his. Poor bastard. He shakes his head. "I'll need to go returning to the Countess immediately, then. Thank you for bringing me this."
Welcome.
He marches off and heads back up to the palace district. He looks pretty exhausted, but he heads out very dutifully without complaint. Fal, you can roll another check.
Yep. How many more are these? 4.
That was number 1. That was 2, number 4.
This
3,
is
number.
This is 4.
4.
That's,
wait.
No,
one
that was
a reroll.
Last was 5.
Oh yeah, that was 4. That was 4.
Yep.
So that was your 5th one?
Yeah.
This is my 4th.
No, this is your 5th.
Yeah.
That was a reroll because I failed and then Fortune pointed it.
One, yeah, but see, two, there's one, and then Vivandrel rolls her eyes. Three. Two, oh, three. Vivandrel no, smiles.
The first one was me performing the rites on him.
Right. Okay, so this is the fourth one. You know what? We'll just let that count. Because okay. It's the same check. I'm just going to save enough. Myself the time. So, okay, so that was number five.
Fair enough.
All right, Vivandrel, you make it back to the inn without too much of a hustle. And when you enter the inn, at first you don't find Anna. Eventually you do locate her. She seems to have fallen asleep while she was cleaning out the pretty high-quality latrine or toilet area that Holst has installed in his wonderful establishment. Thankfully, it's clean. Though it seems that once she was able to rest her head on something, she almost immediately passed out.
Shall I let her stay? No. Anna!
She snaps awake and seems to mumble to herself something about, I'm clean, and then she sort of starts to slowly doze off again.
I walk up and prod her gently with my foot.
At this, she groans loudly before realizing that it's you and not, in fact, Holst that's come to bother her. And she jumps up excitedly, almost like a lightning bolt, and says, "Oh, you're back! It's been really boring here. I don't want to do any more chores. I thought I was going to get away from that when I left the temple, but Holst is even worse."
Anna, we have to earn our keep. You're not here, expenses paid. Thus... we do the work asked of us.
She grumbles under her breath, and you take it that she does not seem to like Hulse's way of finding payment, and she'd much be you figure she's the kind of girl that would be much more at home digging graves. Hulse sees her and rolls his eyes, and he says, "Ah, get off to bed, you little scamper."
About to say, if you guys really have a thing, you could always send her off to help me.
She would not be very helpful.
I'm not dragging my ass and hers all the way back over there.
She stomps up the stairs and heads to her allotted room, which is a very, very safe room. Holst actually paid extra to put very, very high quality iron bars on the window just to make absolutely certain nothing crazy happens.
How many locks are there on the door?
None, actually.
Problem.
Yeah, problem.
Anyway, does Fao have another check, or can I get to grilling the barkeep?
You can head to bed, which would allow him to roll another check, or you could do the barkeep, be the one.
Barkeep, this wizard.
He sighs and pulls up something and leans heavily on the bar and says, "Lord Almeric, aye. Pretty mysterious fellow, but I'll tell you what I know of him. I've seen him in one battle, one time. Almeric's not the sort that likes to go out into the field very often, but there was one time we were fighting around some giant hunk of green stone. Weird stone, if I had to guess. Maybe warp stone." He scratches his chin for a moment and says, "Anyway, Lord Almeric took a mighty large interest in such a large hunk. We were fighting some terrible beast, man, a lot of mutants. When he showed up on the battlefield, things swayed real quick. Where a whole company sent from Nome was struggling to hold out against an enemy, we were outnumbered 10-1. The moment Almeric arrived, you knew we did. Because a huge pit opened up the ground and at least a third of the enemy fell down screaming. Next thing we know, the hole's gone with not a single corpse in sight. Unnerving stuff, that."
"And why does he want us?"
At this, she shrugs and says, "Genuinely? I'm not sure. But it must have something to do with all those stones that have been hitting the city recently. I think he knew the first one was coming, because every time there's been a stone, he's always right there, ready to take a look at it. He's far too obsessed with the things. Unhealthily so, if you ask me."
"What does he look like?"
At this, he sort of chuckles and says, "Lord Elmerick's not the type to allow most people to see him. You'll know when you see him, because he's almost constantly cloaked in shadow. I've never seen the man's face. The best I can tell you is that he has a staff that he uses primarily to walk on, and he seems to have a pretty tall hat, or he could just be a pretty tall fellow, but he's literally like a blotch of shadow that just walks around.
Sotek, am I dream? Do I get dreams in the middle of the ceremony, or no?
No.
Am I just awake the whole time?
Nope. You are getting very little sleep, and the sleep you have is restless.
Okay.
But it is very intensive labor what you're doing. It is very hard work, mentally and physically.
Okay.
Which colors does he dress in?
And he sort of rolls his eyes and says, "Gray, like most of the weirdos of his college."
Exclusively gray?
He nods and says, "Well, I've never seen him wear anything different, though not that I'd be able to tell."
Very well. I shall away, I think.
He nods and leans back from the bar and says, "I think Riken said he'd be coming by on the morrow. You might be able to get some more answers from him."
Who?
He sort of raises an eyebrow and says, "Riken. Otto, the wizard you're employed with."
Ah, the forgettable gentleman. Good trick for a shadow wizard.
He sort of winks and says, "Be careful, I hear they can do that sort of thing."
I'll see you on the morrow.
He nods and he starts tidying up the place, preparing for bed. Foul, roll another check. Alright, that's check 6.
Would you be so kind as to fail one at some point, Val?
No.
Alright, as morning comes, you indeed find none other than... Oops, I need to grab him real quick. You find Otto Riken sitting at a table downstairs, looking as disheveled as ever, but he looks to be in a relatively cheery mood. Anna is still sleeping in, and you can actually hear her snoring through her door.
But not the whole floor down.
She may be someone who is intricately tied in with death, but she certainly is not as silent as it.
I order the usual from the barkeep, and I walk it over to the table with the wizard.
Okay. As you sit, Otto Natsu says, "Ah, dear wizard. Dear elf, it's been a little while. I trust you're holding up well."
Of course.
He nods and says, "I come to you with a task from our proprietor, so to speak." He pulls out a small map and marks a town not too far north, a little bit into the right wall, and says, "We haven't heard much news from a town here, and some of the magic blowing in from this area is strange. Lord Almeric wishes for it to be investigated, but he's too busy with his research, and he needs me here at the moment. So we'd like to send you lot out instead to investigate what's going on."
Very well. You know how much I enjoy this forest by now, surely.
Yeah, he gives you kind of a guilty smile and shrugs and says, "Alas, I would go with you if I could. I'll join you as quick as I can once my duties are done here. But we will be providing you with some faster transportation."
I'm looking forward to this.
He sort of waves his hand towards the door and says, "I had some horses brought over. You may pick one if you'd like. That being said, we would ask that you return them to us upon once you are back from your journey, so to speak."
Sure.
He nods and says, There's three of them if you decide to bring anyone else with you, though it may be quite dangerous."
I'd say that's a very good reason to bring someone with me.
At this point, Anna sleepily stumbles downstairs and out into the main area, and she just sort of like, wanders, swaying pretty badly, until she sort of just unceremoniously sits herself down across from the wizard, and he looks down at her with raised eyebrows, and she blearily looks up at him, and then she looks at you, and then she looks back at him, and she frowns, and she says, "The dwarf's taller than I thought he would be."
He's shorter than I thought he would be.
Otto chuckles and says, "Ah, my dear lass, I'm afraid I am not a dwarf. Quite the opposite, in fact." She rubs her eyes and seems to mumble something to herself and then just sort of lets her head fall onto the table and falls back to sleep. Otto stares down at her for a moment and raises an eyebrow at Vivandrel, says, "Friend of yours?"
Apparently so.
He chuckles and says, "It's pretty rare to see an elf traveling with a human child these days."
"We're not traveling very far in this establishment."
He looks around and says, "Ah, a matter of holding up in the same place then, I see."
"Have you not heard?"
He frowns.
"Ravencloak is dead."
At this, both of his eyebrows shoot up, and he immediately bites on his inner lip. And he seems
to... Everyone's doing that.
He seems to frown down at the table and says, "These are dark times indeed, if we've lost someone as potent as Ravencloak."
"I don't think it was much of a coincidence at this point, shall we say?"
He frowns and looks at you sternly and says, "What do you mean?"
"Common knowledge check on Warpstone."
"Ah, yeah, that's fine."
Meaning he doesn't need one, or...?
"No, I
know." "No, go ahead and take one. I'll tell you what you know based on how you roll." "Ah! You found a glowy green thing in his neck."
"I'll reroll that."
"Okay." Alright. You're pretty good about Warpstone.
Warpstone.
He sighs, and one of his hands very, very shakily comes up to press against his left temple, and he says, "So, what happened in the poor quarter, then?"
"Perhaps not so much. He was in a good deal of pain when we found him. Well, when we found him. He was in a good deal of pain at the end, but it was still him."
He nods his head slowly and says, "Ah, my research is close to finished on what exactly is going on in that department. I think I have an inkling of an idea what the rat men are up to, but I'm afraid I need a few more confirmations before I can say anything for certain."
"I'm curious, then. I'll get right on it."
He nods and says, "The town you're going to is named Grisenwald. It's not too far from here in the Reichwald. Once you're there, if you find anything interesting, hopefully it can help me in my research. But all Lord Almeric wishes to know is if the town is intact." And he seems to frown for a moment and says, "Strange, now that you mention it. I wonder if he'll be interested in Ravencloak's death. He did say something rather odd yesterday."
"Do tell."
He just frowns at you and says, "He just seemed very certain that he had finally dealt with an itch he had been trying to scratch. He seemed rather pleased with himself, but he didn't say what it was about."
"Very well."
He leans back heavily and says, "I know those two were never close. In fact, they had quite opposite views on many things and hated one another within the Countess's court. But I can't possibly think Lord Almeric would have any reason to go after Ravencloak."
"At some point, I imagine, I shall have to have a word with this Countess."
He sort of smirks in your direction and says, "If you should be so lucky. She's rare to get an audience with, especially with all the turmoil in the city. But your little group does seem to have a natural ability for finding your way into important events, so perhaps."
"Usually because we're sent to them."
He nods and says, "Well, I best be on my way then. I'm going to go see if I can make any further advancement on my research, and perhaps I'll pass by the temple to pay my respects."
Very well.
He nods to you and smirks down at the girl that has a pretty significant drool puddle under her face by now. And he heads out.
He's so adorable.
Barkeep, go a little easy on this one today, perhaps.
He rolls his eyes, he rolls his eyes and very sarcastically says, "But actually, I don't think he knows your name." He says, "But how will I afford all the wine she's drinking me out of at this rate? The girl is going to run me out of business."
If you can pay for the dwarf, you can pay for her.
He sort of jabs a finger at the dwarf's usual sitting spot and says, "The only reason he's getting away with not paying as much is because I know how thick his arms are." And then he sort of winks and heads back to work. Fowl, take your last check.
Reroll.
Okay, this is your last chance.
There we go.
Passed all seven. Very good. All right, you finished performing a very symbolic, very potent, and very emotionally, spiritually, and physically draining internment ritual. Many people come by to pay their respects. After you have finished performing the rites and preparing the body, it is set out in a bit of a open casket display. Many influential figures come by. There's even some rumors that the Countess arrived herself, though honestly, you're so tired, you miss most of this pomp and...
Pamper, or whatever it's called.
Pomp and circumstance, whatever.
Yeah, something like that.
Well, that's the song. But anyway. and finally, he is interred in a very, very high-quality tomb, or sarcophagus, that was forged very quickly by the dwarves, like alarmingly quickly, almost as if they knew.
Right.
And it's a beautiful work of art, and it's got like very intricate raven carvings and small notes of various scriptures from very famous and important, probably to him, Morrite texts. And it's phenomenal. And the dwarves runically seal it, which is very uncommon for them, even for some of the most important of people. And they seem to have held Ravencloak in very high esteem. And he is finally put to rest in a rather humble-looking spot within his very precious flower garden.
Mm-hmm. I nod respectfully to the dwarves as I try to stay awake.
Those few of them who managed to make it in any reasonable time to witness part of your preparations, which is very few of them, nod back to you respectfully. And you've gained some esteem, but you hear rumors floating about the church as you finally prepare to leave and return to the inn that Sigmund has heard of what you have done, and rumor has it, he will not be happy when he returns to the church.
So, as a side note, was there anything else in Ravencloak's will?
No.
Okay. So I return to the inn.
Okay. So you return to the inn, and you are dead tired. But, nonetheless, you make it back in one piece. And as you enter, Holst, almost seemingly aware of what task you've accomplished, puts a drink out for you and walks away from the bar without saying anything. And Anna seems to give you a pretty respectful, solemn distance upon your return.
Okay, can I spawn another?
Yeah, I'm getting it.
Okay. I sit down, take the drink, and look at Holst and say, "So how's our guest?"
He pauses and looks over in Anna's general direction. She seems to be messing with something that she's found on the table, and he shrugs and says, "Not bad for free labor, I guess."
Good.
He nods and winks and says, "Do you want to hear a secret?"
Sure.
He sort of nods at where the dwarf usually sits and says, "You missed quite the interaction earlier."
Oh?
"She came down quite early one morning before the elf got up, met the dwarf. It was a rather amusing interaction."
"I'm sure. I'm sorry I missed it."
He shrugs and says, "She seems to have mistaken dear Otto Riken for him as well. Curious girl, that one."
"Aren't we all?" And I begin to down the drink before I... Do I see the elf?
Yeah, you see her.
I down my drink and then walk over to the elf.
She's leaning on her table rather languidly.
"So, any news come in while I was away?"
"Not so much. There is a village we could go to if you're interested."
"Sure.
How many horses are there outside?"
"There are 3.
"Not you, Sotek. But I suppose that'll do."
"Never mind."
"I saw 3 as I walked up. Are these related?"
"A gift from our friend, the wizard."
"Interesting." As a side note, Sotek, do I heal a single wound for every day I was doing a ritual?
No.
Which part of this no sleep did you not understand, pal?
Can I try and heal myself then?
Sure.
No.
Oh, wow.
Take 2 wounds.
Ah.
You stumble horribly.
So, how did you do that? They're only bandages.
He stabs himself horribly with the thing he uses to put stitches in.
Well done, priest. We could have used you in better form, not worse.
I still have a fortune point, right?
No, until you sleep, you're done.
No, I've only used 2.
Yes, for the entire week-long event that you were awake for.
Yes, but I have 3 fortune points.
Oh, okay, yes, then you have 1 left. Alright, fine.
Double 100.
Okay, I do not take
2. Hey, who's GM here?
Hey. Well, I didn't roll a 100, so it's not catastrophic failure. And?
Yeah, that's fine.
Worth it. So, where is this village you spoke of?
Sounds like which direction is it?
North. Eastish.
The village of Kriswald. Northeast.
Well then. I'd rather get some sleep, but I have a feeling we best be going.
You should probably sleep for just 1 night.
Okay. Actually, in that case, I will sleep for a night. I basically pass out at the table.
I stay here for a bit longer and then I go back. Then I turn in at my time.
Anna walks towards you sheepishly and she almost seems to pout at Mikael for being gone so long. And then she gives the elf a rather devilish grin. Mikael, take a perception check. No, he doesn't.
Oh, Lord.
She moves silently, and Vivandrel, you are actually pretty impressed at how quietly this girl can move when she wants to. And she very, very deftly and silently brings out a small piece of charcoal and draws a bunch of seemingly random squiggles over Mikhail's face, and then, seemingly satisfied with her work, goes to bed.
Vivandrel is highly impressed with the entire affair.
Okay.
Anyway, so, as I said, I will amuse myself at Pal's expense, Mikhail's expense for a little longer, and then I will go to bed myself.
Okay, so do I wake up and realize there's charcoal on my face?
No.
Roll a perception check.
Nope.
No. That being said, as Holst comes down from his room in the morning, he gives you a rather interested. He gives you a very strange look and sort of makes a gesture, as if to scratch his face at you. And he looks concerned, and then he sort of shakes his head, and heads back behind the bar.
I sigh and go, "Anna." Do I heal another wound?
Yes, you heal the wound, you get your fortune points back, and you hear high-pitched laughter coming from upstairs, but it's unclear which female it's coming from.
Can I have some water?
Hulse nods and says, "Water I can always provide."
Thank you. I proceed to wash my face.
He smirks and says, "You have to watch out for that one. I tell you, she's a devilish imp just wearing wearing a girl's skin."
Perhaps. But still, I was...
They say that... he sort of smirks for a moment and says, "They say that girl's blessed by Moore, but in my book, she's blessed by Ranald. I don't trust her with... I don't trust her anywhere near my stash."
even so, I was asked... It was Ravencloak's last wish that I take care of her, so I will.
He nods, and he sort of looks over you and sort of gives you a small smile and says, "I appreciate what you did for him, lad."
Yes.
Vivandrel enters the tavern on the same floor from the staircase and says, walking over to Mikael, "That we look after her."
Indeed.
"Not you."
Indeed, Lady Vivandrel.
Hulse raises his eyebrow and says, "Forgive me for overhearing, but I hear you're both heading out today."
"Yes."
He nods and says, "We'll keep an eye on the girl. The Master Dwarf said he'd probably be back this day, and I also hear the Bounty Hunter's on his way back as well, if rumors hold true."
"Good."
Try and keep him from falling over as he enters the...
He waves his hand nonchalantly in there and says, "I can't promise the impossible, Elf."
"I also try and make sure Anna doesn't follow us."
He nods and says, "Ah, you won't have to worry about that. The girl's got plenty of chores she skipped out on yesterday when you came back."
"Did I ever tell you how I met our barkeep?"
He shakes his head.
"Good. Keep an eye on her. And I mean that."
He nods and seems to give a rather serious sharp look at the stairs.
Okay, so I turn, start walking towards the door.
As do I.
Okay, y'all head outside and you find some riding horses with saddles and harnesses. You're not necessarily the most skilled of riders, but you can manage to stay on a horse's back if you have to. Come push or shove.
So we ride to the city, the town then.
Alright, you head out of the northern gate and make off to the northeast, deeper into the Reichwald. And it doesn't take long before you spot smoke on the horizon. A lot of smoke.
Never a good sign.
She reminds me of someone. I can't think who. Yes, I can. Anyway, no. But then, the wizard did want to know if the town was intact or not, and I thought that it was quite telling.
He said intact.
Intact.
Strange wording, that.
I think it's quite pertinent. You can say that, can you not?
Indeed. Perhaps we should hurry.
Ready, great.
Do you wish to approach?
Yes, and I ready hammer and shield.
Okay, as you ride closer, it would be pertinent for the GM to note that while you may try to fight from horseback, if you do not have the right skill, it's a very bad idea, so you should probably tie your horses out somewhere safe.
And perhaps we should approach on foot. I'd rather not have the wizard yell at us for harming his horses.
Fine.
Or, you know, falling to your deaths.
So
he yells at the horses if we fall to our deaths. Yes, we tie the horses at a tree.
Okay, as you approach the city, the stench of death is overwhelming.
Even for my guy?
You know, you both, without fail, notice a horrifically strong, very familiar, sickly sweet odor.
Not a good sign.
With every town, we get a little closer.
Indeed.
Would
and
you
the
like
plot
to?
Thickens.
Would you like to enter Grisenwald?
Is there? How many entrances are there?
You could technically approach it from any angle, but it doesn't make much of a difference. The outer skirts of the city or town are pretty much flattened.
Flattened.
Looks like there was a bit of a fight.
Let's go in then.
Let's be cautious.
Okay, you enter Grisenwald, and I'm actually going to send that horse way over here. And the first thing you note are bodies everywhere, and lots of rats.
Living rats?
Living rats.
It appears our furry friends have been here. Can I take it? Can I throw a perception check?
Uh-huh.
Nope.
Can I throw one?
Mm-hmm.
With eyes?
Okay.
Da-da-da-da-da-da.
Da-da.
No.
There is a corpse in front of you guys being eaten by a small swarm of rats.
Where have I seen this before? Careful. These are not the only things around, most likely.
Indeed. I cautiously begin advancing. Shield and
okay.
Camera ready.
As you advance, you hear a weird... It almost sounds like speech, but it just sounds like a really fast-paced, successive drone of high squeaking.
I try and locate the sound.
Roll a perception check.
I'll do the same with ears.
Nice.
Your ears hone in very carefully on two figures, and you notice these rats are much larger than the rest, hunched over two bodies, so they are most definitely consuming them, and they have weapons. But you also hear the sound of bone being crunched on coming from the building to your left.
Hear anything else? I whisper.
Oh, yes. Building on the left. Be quiet.
Good. Anything else?
Yes, but that wouldn't be any fun, would it? They are further down the road.
Understood.
Okay.
Stay behind me. Let me take them on my shield.
Hold on. I believe I have silent move.
I believe you do.
I do. Oh, bugger. fortune point.
Ah, okay.
No, I'm not falling down a crack in the floor.
you don't want to pull a Mines of Moria?
Ooh.
Let's see.
Oh, it's almost a pass.
Okay, you may attempt to move. We will see what happens.
We'll go to the front.
Okay, as you approach, the sound of something messily chewing on flesh and guts gets a lot louder.
Is the door intact, or is it...
Nope, it's been smashed off its hinges.
Is the rest of the walls intact?
Yes.
Oh. Take handle what's inside. I'll cover the door.
Thank you so much. Round the corner.
Okay. As you do, you will get a surprise attack against it, but you see a giant rat.
How giant?
Pretty big. It's
how long is it, Sotek? Vast.
Oh god, what are they called? Princess Bride.
The rodents of unusual size.
Yes.
Why would I have seen this film?
Are you asses?
You turn the. It's probably about 4 feet long.
Oh, so it's just a regular Skaven then. Wonderful.
Well, it's not a Skaven. It's literally a giant rat.
Oh, sorry, 4 feet long. Yes.
Yes. But it does not notice you as you come in behind it.
Here we
so
go.
So you may swing for free.
We'll do an aim strike.
Okay. I should have done all out.
Damn it. Yeah, but that's a 20% bonus to hit me. I'll fortune point.
All right, you hit. Roll damage.
Got a 12. Yeah.
A 12. All right. You raise your great axe into the air, and before the creature even notices you, you bring your axe slamming down and just crunch through its spine, and it just instantly dies.
At this point, I slide into the door and cover it with my shield.
Okay. You hear nothing from outside.
That's one.
Yes.
Pretty, isn't it?
A fine specimen. Perhaps we should bring it back to the Master Dwarf. I think he'd enjoy that one.
Shall we call the others first?
Indeed.
So, like, do I know where exactly they are, or do I have just an...
Yeah, no, you know where they are.
Okay, so...
You have a very, very strong sense of where they are.
So, would you be so kind as to point them out on the map for me?
They're the ones...
They're right in front of you.
Yeah, front of my eye.
Oh, I thought those were corpses. Fair enough.
They're meaning the corpses.
There are corpses, yes.
Sorry, I thought those were all...
Yeah, corpses. The two of you are close enough, and thankfully for you both... Your sound at that distance has been covered by them talking to one another and eating.
What's the minimum range for a charge?
I believe it is 12 feet.
I am 18 feet away from the closest one.
And I'm 22 from the furthest.
Yeah, you both can charge. And you'll get a surprise round since you're catching them off guard.
On three. Should we roll initiative? Or?
No, you roll initiative after you after surprise rounds.
I'll take the one closest. Foul gets the other.
In character.
Or should we both go for the same one?
Shall we one-on-one, or shall we try to take out one quickly?
They're only rats. Take your pick.
Very well. I will cover the furthest.
I'll take the closest.
Right, then. Together, shall we?
All right. The Vandrel, your higher agility, so go first.
Okay, we so charge.
Yeah, do I move my guy too?
Yeah, go ahead and move. Roll to hit. You're at plus 10%. Okay, got roll him. Damage.
Useful. I'm actually typing into the box.
I need to get you some macros at some point.
Critical.
Ooh, nice.
Roll to hit.
Come on.
You need a 55 or lower.
Come on.
No. That being said, you did what?
14.
You run up behind this Skaven and bring your axe slashing around in an arc and just cleave his head completely clean off from his shoulders. And squirting blood from his now decapitated head and shoulder and that whatever the hell neck. You call that stump of a neck. He falls to his knees and stumbles over. Okay. Foul roll to hit. Hit.
Okay.
Roll damage.
Ten damage.
Okay. You run up behind it, behind this Skaven, and bring your hammer whirling around and slam it into one of its back legs. And it goes down with a pretty high-pitched squeal and then turns to you snarling. Roll initiative.
Come on, beastie. Let's dance.
That's terrible, even by our standards.
he got a 48. Vivandrel got a 51. Okay, Vivandrel's up first.
I'll move into contact with this one and attack him normally.
Quick, let's end this.
Plus 10%.
Yay.
Nope. then it's his turn. He slashes out at Foul. And he hits, surprisingly.
Nope, he doesn't.
Okay, roll a hit, Foul.
I aim.
Okay, plus 20%.
Nope.
Okay, Vivandrel, you're up.
aim strike.
No. Okay, his turn. He is actually going to screech something in his weird tongue, and you hear the sounds of other Skaven approaching.
Damn it. So, do I go?
Yes.
Good.
12.
Okay. You bring your hammer flashing around as he's mid-cry and bring it slamming into his arm, and there's a pretty solid crack. And using the momentum of the force, you slam him onto the ground, and his head bashes against the stone beneath, and he is dead.
Should we roll initiative again, or...?
No, just keep initiative order. Okay. So, Vivandrel, you're up next.
I'll take one coming in behind us.
Okay, the giant rat.
What's maximum range on charges?
It is your movement times 4.
So, 20.
Okay. Or no, your movement times 3, but it's in yards.
All right. So, yeah, he's in.
Okay, charge.
Charge indeed.
Okay, plus 10%.
Plus 10%.
Nope.
Fuck me.
The giant rat will attack Vivandrel and miss horribly. This Skaven is going to charge the Morrite and miss terribly. And this Skaven comes running around the corner.
Okay. My turn.
Yep.
You got him.
Okay, he does not parry. Roll damage.
5.
Nice.
Not it. Yeah.
Okay, let's see, 5.
I'm clearly paying attention to the other one trying to come in on my side.
74. Well, at least you got him in. 74 is body?
I believe so.
Alright, you bring your hammer slamming into his chest, and he sort of yelps, but doesn't seem overtly affected by it.
Okay.
Alright, hey. Vivandrel.
Sorry, aim strike.
Okay, roll damage.
Got him. Got a 13.
Alright, you bring your axe slashing around as it leaps for you, and you cleave straight through its open mouth about halfway down its body, splitting it pretty evenly before ripping your axe out in a pretty gory display.
Excellent.
Alright, their turn. This rat is going to move in and attack Mikael.
Just hold on, fell. I'm coming.
Miss. And the second one will also miss.
Okay, I will swing at the one I already hindered.
Okay.
Aiming, so cancel out the plus 10.
Okay.
Nope.
Nope. Vivandrel, you're up.
I charge the one on Fowl's left.
Okay, that's fine.
Excellent.
Plus 10%.
Ascendant, do we hear any more Skaven coming?
No.
Okay.
We're kind of busy.
That's a head. Does not parry. Roll damage.
So that's a head shot. Got a 11.
11? Okay.
Yeah. Fowl, which one were you swinging for?
The one you're hitting.
Alright. He's probably dead.
My job's not to kill them, it's to set them up for you.
So that's definitely a headshot.
Alright, you bring your axe hurtling around and cleave off a significant part of the top right portion of his head, including one of his ears, and he screeches horribly, and then comes attacking back at you in a pretty hard frenzy, and he misses. The bottom one will swing for the Morrite, and he also misses.
Okay, I will swing at the wounded one, aiming.
Okay, plus 10%.
So, nope.
Nope, Vivandrel.
Aim strike.
Okay.
No,
you might as well, you know, just so you know.
We'll go all out.
Okay, yeah, I was gonna say, there's no reason for you not to. Okay.
Got him.
He
that
does not parry.
As well.
Roll damage.
Got an 11 again.
Alright, you bring your axe thudding home into the open space you've already cleaved in his head, piercing the skull and slicing his brains pretty well in half.
What a little of their arm.
The final clan rat, he seems to shake violently, and there's this sudden foul odor in the air, and he tries to run for his life.
Alright.
Are we both in contact with him?
Yes, you may both swing.
No.
No.
What? That was the wrong... I hit the wrong button, actually.
It doesn't matter, you still rolled an 80.
I don't even know what button I hit.
No, you both miss. All right, and he skitters off much faster than y'all are going to be able to chase him.
Shit.
All right, and he vanishes, and the village is now eerily quiet, save for the squeaks of these some of the smaller rats that are seemingly running around blindly in a panic.
Amusing, but insufficient.
Indeed. We should. Let's look around, shall we?
Absolutely.
Okay. Throw a perception check.
Okay. Alright, before you is a large fountain that seems to be the origin of the sickly sweet odor you know so well. However, as you pass by various bodies, it takes very little for you to realize that many of them seem to have been half transformation almost. Some of them have waxy flesh, some of them have weird-looking boils, some had like almost a tiny developing third arm coming out of their exposed back. It looked like, and you see all those, you see multiple small green shards in many of them. But for whatever reason, it seems that these did not transform nearly as successfully as the ones in Nuln did.
A failed attempt, perhaps?
Perhaps.
I approach the fountain.
Okay.
Can I throw a perception for anything else? For example, anything
sure.
We might have missed in the buildings.
That's fine.
Are you using eyes? Da-da-da-da. No.
No. You look around the buildings for a while, and you find much the same story, kicking the occasional rat out of your way or crunching it underneath. And when the two of you finally gather back into the center of the village, suddenly the wind seems to pick up a little, and you both can smell some sort of, like, it's almost like a weird burning ozone, like, very metallic. It's weird. And the hairs on the back of your neck stand up.
I have a feeling we should take cover.
Fine idea.
So, retreat into one of the more defensible buildings.
Okay.
Which is the building with the least number of entrances?
Just go up.
There you go.
Call it this one.
Okay, as you both enter the building, suddenly you hear a horse crying out, neighing. But there's something really weird about it. Like, it's very distorted. And as you hear it, but you don't hear any galloping. And after a few moments, a shadow passes overhead at an alarming speed and slams down before the fountain. And when the shadow disperses, you see none other than Otto Ryken standing there.
Master Wizard.
Shadow State. Wonderful.
I emerge from the building. Master Wizard.
He looks up suddenly and seems to grip his staff threateningly in your direction and says, Oh, it's just you lads. Well, and you, my lady. And he lowers his staff.
Indeed.
He frowns looking around and says, this used to be quite the thriving little town. I was quite fond of the bread that came from Grisenwald.
Yes, it appears they found a rather foul fate. So, Sotek, out of character lore thing, is my guy obligated to do the rites on these people?
Technically, yes.
Okay.
As they are still mostly human.
Okay, so I will throw that check.
Okay.
Pass.
Good job. you start wandering around, gently putting their bodies in more dignified positions. And flicking off what green shards you can, chasing away rats. As Otto Ryken leans over the pool of fountain water, he very, very deftly pulls out a small instrument and dips in the water and pulls it back out and looks at it for a moment. And then he looks around and examines some of the bodies.
Do I finish by this point?
Yeah, you make a pretty quick roundabout. Offering very, very on the fly Blessings of Mor.
Find anything useful, Master Wizard?
He stares, he kneels down by one of the corpses that seems to have had most of his chest melt away like burning wax, and he nods and says, I think I've discovered what the ratmen are up to.
That almost seems self-evident.
He looks at him and says, ah, yes, but I think I know exactly what they've been trying to do and why they were more successful and known.
I thought perhaps this was a failed attempt. Do you know why?
He nods and he gestures to the water and says, they've been mixing their growth formula. I've seen it before in some of my research on the Underfolk. There's one particular clan amongst them. They go by the name of Clan Mulder. They have an art, a terrible, abominable creation that they call flesh molding, which they use to create terrible, horrific monsters by melding different creatures together. It seems that they found a way to accelerate the process, alarmingly.
Wait, Underfolk? I pull out the book from the temple.
Perhaps... He glances at the book and smirks for a moment and says, ah, it's been a while since I've seen that particular tale. I'm afraid it probably won't be of much use to you, however.
Very good. A pity. I put the book back. It was the only book remaining in the temple about these creatures.
He frowns at this and says, in the Temple of Mor, there should have at least been quite a stack. That's where we kept no small amount of important texts.
Yes, but where all those books, along with those of the beastmen, were missing.
He frowns and looks down at the water and says, regardless, we'll have to worry about that another time. Now that we know who's behind this and what they're up to, I can only fear for what stands for our city if these ratmen are not dealt with quickly. That being said, we have very little information on where they're operating from.
During the incident in this peasant in the poor quarter, it began when I opened up a grate to the sewers. Perhaps they lie beneath the city.
Hinan says, "Aye, we've had the dwarven folk already scouring beneath the city. This isn't our first time to deal with the foul Skaven. That being said, they haven't turned up anything yet, so I would suggest you stay on your toes. The ratmen are a very cunning enemy, and they likely aren't out of tricks yet. That being said, thanks to the discoveries here and this not as perfected version of their growth formula, I think I might be able to form some form of antidote to at least purify some of the wells in Nome, but it will take time."
Is there anything we can do to help?
He shakes his head and says, be patient and try to stay alive. I may need you to gather certain things for me in the meantime. That being said, I would be very, very careful. The closer you get to finding the source or potentially even defeating the ratmen, the more you tend to draw their attention.
Of course.
He gives you both a very serious look and says, I can't say for sure who is our enemy and who is an ally at this time. I would recommend you both and your allies be very highly on your guard. Trust no one if you can.
Does that extend to yourself?
He shrugs and says, most don't trust Mike's wizards from my college anyway. I can't say I particularly blame them.
We still don't know how the servants of the Ruinous Powers play into this.
He nods, scratching his chin thoughtfully, and says,
Or this baleful one.
He nods further and says, aye. That being said, I suspect they're all connected.
If only I could find those lost tomes.
He nods and says, I'll keep my ear out for anything I can find on those as well.
But
that being said,
I have some place I could look.
He looks at you quizzically, but shakes his head and holds out a hand and says, the less we discuss, the better. I have my own plans to see to. Don't trust anyone.
Understood. Lady Elf, Lady Vivandrel, would you be willing to take one more trek into the garden?
It's not Lady. Remember that, please.
Very well. Vivandrel, then. Would you be willing to take one more trek into the garden?
As we must.
Good, because there's some place I wish to check.
Otto nods to both of you, and you feel a strange sensation again, and he suddenly seems to just melt into shadow, and suddenly a immense steed that's almost completely ethereal, with him riding upon its shadowed back, goes soaring into the air, heading back towards Nuln.
A useful trick. Come, let us get our own steeds. And I turn and start walking towards the horses.
Okay, you make it out of the ruins of Grisenwald without too much trouble. And as you mount your steeds and begin slowly making your way back towards Nuln, as you're approaching the northern border of the forest, you see something rather spectacular. Well, rather, you hear it first. As you're riding along, you suddenly hear the sound of very sharp cracks, as if something is almost like a whip being snapped. And it seems vaguely heading in the direction of the two of you.
Not again.
Think we can outrun it?
We can try, but on these horses?
Perhaps a fight, then.
No. Hide.
A good choice as well.
Actually, I have a way to... Oh, good. Hold on one sec.
How close are we to the city?
You can actually see it.
I immediately turn... quick, to the trees. And I turn my horse off to hide in the woods.
I slap my horse and send it running towards the gate.
On second thought, I will do the same.
Yeah, so, hide! Really,
wait, the elf is
really
fleeing. Flee!
No, okay. We're saying the horse is on ahead as we hide in the woods.
Yeah.
Oh, you're sending the horses on ahead.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. The horses go sprinting for the gate, and you both duck into the cover of some rather thick bushes, and as the snapping gets closer, the ground begins to shake. As you realize that trees are hitting the ground because something is pushing its way through them.
It's not the damned ogre again, is it?
And as this figure gets closer and closer, you begin to hear the very distinct sound of something large and hard hitting the ground, but it's very rapid and quick. And as it gets closer and closer, you begin to hear a kind of nasally giggling sound. Pretty high-pitched.
Throw concealment.
Okay.
Can I duck in with the elf?
You can try. Alright, the elf conceals. She finds a very well-hidden spot to hide in. And presumably, Mikael, you're not an idiot, and hunker down as best you can.
Oh, wow.
All right, you hide. Well done. After a few moments, the trees before you both part, and a immense creature comes crawling out, each of its very long, spindly legs carrying its rather grotesquely large body along. And both of you almost immediately spot the capering goblin on top of this immense beast as it slowly passes over the two of you. And you are very aware of the continuous smaller brethren of its kind, little tiny spiders crawling all over its bulk as it passes over you, heading for an area you've been to before. And you notice as this massive spider passes over the two of you that it's dragging something behind it, something wrapped in web. And whatever it is, it's rather bulky, but also it's very stocky. And whatever it is, it's very heavy as it's dragging a groove through the ground. And it passes by you being dragged by this immense spider, and you almost feel a sense of sadness as this whatever it is that's been webbed up passes by. And the goblin upon his rather large spider continues on until they pass from sight, heading towards a cave that you are all too familiar with.
Can I
will not help.
Yeah. No, I meant to try and discern the size of the bundle. See if it's perhaps ogre-sized.
I will allow this. It is not. It is smaller than an ogre. It is much smaller than an ogre. It's stocky.
Okay.
Elf, why don't you try?
Yes, allow me to do the same. With eyes, of course. Got him.
The rather immense creature, not the size of a townhouse, mind you, big, but not that big, continues pressing on through the forest and vanishes into the shadows.
I whisper to Vivandrel, I believe we found what was in the cave.
I believe it found someone we may know.
That is troubling. What did you see?
Do you really want to know? You won't get another chance. You won't get another chance at walking on.
What was it? Who was it?
It looked like a dwarf.
Damn it to hell.
But ours is smaller, I thought.
Troubling. Shall we tail it, or shall we keep head on?
I'm not fighting that thing, but there may be some value in trying to get at whoever that was.
Indeed. Let us be very cautious, though.
You want to try and pursue it?
Not really, but it seems we're going
You don't have to. You can go back to Nuln right now.
Yeah.
Well, let's go for it. Come on.
Yeah, whatever.
Okay. Someone needs to roll a very easy follow trail check.
That'll be me.
Person with follow trail.
Yep.
Just don't roll in the 90s.
If we do that, then we've probably saved ourselves.
Quite possibly.
Fair enough. Where is it going?
You follow it for a while, but as it heads deeper and deeper into territory it likely knows, it seems to have somehow altered its path, and the trees just stop and look completely normal. And it's unclear exactly how it proceeded further. That being said, you likely have a safe guess on where it was heading.
Like I said, I think this doesn't this path lead to the cave.
That's a thing you wanted to go into it.
I never said I wanted to go into it. I said I wanted to confirm where it was going.
Not how I remember it. To the city.
Indeed. Once, as I said, I have some place I would like to check.
Alright, you both head back to the city, and it gets, it's pretty dark by the time you get there, and you're both relatively exhausted from the not-so-short trek back.
Can I make a stop at the temple, or is that too exhausting? Well, more specifically, I want to head back to where Frederick's buried. More specifically, his shack.
You can make a stop.
Like, yeah. I want to check his shed.
You may go into his shed. You do not find anything of note. Okay. It's actually extremely sparse.
I was wondering if the tomes may have been in the shed.
There is no evidence of that.
Okay. A pity. I thought perhaps he might have put them here.
Interesting wording, Sotek.
I throw a perception check.
You could try. It does not look like anything was here.
Okay. I rolled single digits and it's still nothing was here. I can assume.
Oh no, if you rolled one, he'd have told you that it was under the floorboards. But you don't have any points left, so.
Yeah, then going for the one is kind of hard.
Kinda. Okay, we're back.
Okay. You both enter the inn, and by the time you arrive, Anna has already gone to bed. Yep. As has Holst. It's actually pretty empty.
Damn it. I wish to ask Holst a question.
Would you like to turn in for the evening?
Is there anything else we can do?
Technically, yes.
Like?
Is there anything else we can use fully there?
Yeah.
Technically, you can do anything.
Any thoughts?
No, not really.
I'm tempted to go to the Dwarf Quarter, but I don't think they'd be awake.
I'm tempted to not go to the Dwarf Quarter. For obvious reasons.
A sound choice.
Good day, priest.
Knight Vivandrel.
Alright, you both head to bed. When morning comes, both of you hear a thunderous boom as something slams open the doors downstairs.
Wonderful.
Grab my weapons and rush downstairs.
Likewise, arrow. Arrow ready.
Okay, as you both rush into the room, you see Anna bouncing excitedly up and down on a stool, and the dwarf has returned, and he looks enraged.
Holst,
yes, your dwarf. And as Holst sees him, he nudges the elf and hands her a small... note, and that is the end of the session.
Can I even read the note?
Yes. The long and short of it is,
the elf doesn't have reader, right?
Yes. Well, magic. Because I'll forget if I don't do this now.
As
a reward for bringing information to Rolf and then assisting with Otto Riken. Because Rolf was not aware that the Morrite was assisting you in your endeavors. He only really cared about hearing about you, for whatever his reasons may be. He has decided to allow you to keep one of the horses.
Which we presume were recovered by the guard.
Someone got them, yes.
Yes.
And worst case scenario, there was one more outside. So, you may add to your trappings... a horse with saddle and
I'm not writing this one's encumbrance.
Obviously not. You do not carry the horse. You ride it, and the horses can carry an absurd amount of encumbrance. Actually very useful for characters that prefer heavy equipment.
Like me.
Yes, but that will help you on your way to becoming a scout.
Are the saddle and the thing a separate category to the horse, or is it just horse with saddle?
Technically, the saddle and harness are separate things, but you can just basically combine them.
Fair enough.
Because the horse is always carrying them.
Yes. That being said, I will probably make time in the near future to... Well, okay. Thanks everyone for watching. I'm going to go ahead and... I will end the session here. You will find out any important information that happens after this at the start of the next group session. Thanks so much for watching. Goodbye.